Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We praise your name. Just begin to praise him. Oh, we praise you, Lord. We praise you. We praise you, God. We praise you, Lord. Oh, we magnify your name, Jesus. Oh, we love you, we love you, we love you. Oh, we love you, we love you, we love you, Lord. We love you. Oh, we love you, we love you, we love you, we love you, Lord. Oh, mighty is your name. Mighty is the name of Jesus. Oh, so mighty is your name. Oh, holy, holy, holy one. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're the one. You're the one true God, and you're the reason that we're here, Lord. We worship you. We worship you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. What a sweet, sweet name. Oh, the name of Jesus. Jesus. every chain, break 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 every chain. All sufficient, all sufficient sacrifice, so free. We honor you, Lord. We honor you, Jesus. We honor you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Praise your holy name. Praise your holy name. Praise your name, God. Oh, we love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Jesus. I love you, God. I love you, Lord. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I praise you, God. Lord, we just thank you tonight, Lord, that no matter what we face in life, Lord, you are mighty to save, Lord. You are mighty. You are mighty. Lord, there's nothing that's impossible with you, Jesus. There's nothing that's impossible with you. Hallelujah. Lord, you've been given a name that's above every name. Hallelujah. The name of Jesus. That precious and holy and mighty name. Everything must bow, Lord. Everything must bow. We just thank you, God, that you are mighty to save. And we worship you tonight as the mighty God, the mighty Savior, the mighty Lord. I thank you, Lord, that sickness and disease cannot stand in your presence. Hallelujah. I thank you, Lord, that poverty cannot stand in your presence. Father, I thank you that unforgiveness can't stand in your presence, Lord. Father, I just thank you. I thank you that fear cannot stand in your presence, Almighty God. We serve a mighty God. We serve a mighty God. You are mighty to save, Lord. You are mighty to save. You are mighty to save. You are mighty to save. Hallelujah. Mighty, 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 mighty God. Mighty, 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 mighty God. You are mighty to save. 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 What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve, Lord. Oh God, you never leave us nor forsake us. You're always there with us, oh Lord. You're the God who sees, the God who hears, the God who saves. Oh, you are Hosanna, oh Lord in the highest. And you are mighty to save. You are mighty to save. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. And you are mighty to save. 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 Jesus, so we give you all the glory, for it all belongs to you. We give you all the glory, for all glory belongs to you. Sing, I give you all the glory. I give you all the glory, for all the glory, for all the glory belongs to you. I give you all the glory. Give you all the glory, for all the glory belongs to you. What a mighty God.
Mighty, mighty God.
What a mighty God. I give you all the glory. Give you all the glory, for all the glory, for all the glory belongs to you. I give you all the glory, for all the glory belongs to you. God. mighty God. I give you all the glory, for all the glory belongs to you. I give you all the glory, for all the glory belongs to you. I give you all the glory, for all the glory belongs to you.
Jesus, you are a mighty God. You're our mighty God. You're our mighty deliverer. You're a mighty Savior. You're our mighty healer. You are our mighty peace, our mighty strength. You're our mighty everything. And we do give you all the glory. And the more we know you, the more we understand you, the more we grow in you, the more glory we know how to give you. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you. Sometimes it just seems difficult to comprehend the fullness of what you've done for us. And so much of it is exactly what you shared in your word, that it's a walk of faith on our part. We don't understand how lost we really were. And we don't understand how saved we really are. But we are growing in that knowledge and that understanding. And I'm thankful for that. I do appreciate my salvation, Jesus. I'm so glad that I have the life that I'm living. And Father, tonight, all of us who are here, all who are watching, our desire is to be changed more and more into the image of the glory of Jesus Christ. And tonight, Father, I believe that this is another step in that direction. Thank you so much that we have peace, that we have healing, that we have everything you have promised, including victory over the devil and everything he represents. Thank you for tonight, Father. Thank you for your work. May it be completed in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Well, guys, take a few moments and get around and greet some people. They really need it. What a fine looking bunch of people. Thank you for being here, and all of you who are watching, thank you for being with us as well. It's good to sort of like see you. I mean, I see the camera, but so I believe you're out there somewhere. Hey, listen, this coming Friday night, bonfire, you know, good old hot dogs and whatever else is brought in. Sign-up sheet's still in the rear for people to sign up to bring in food. And those of you who are watching, hey, you're invited this coming Friday night. And, you know, you don't have to bring anything. I mean, you can if you want to, but there'll be plenty of food. And it's going to start at 6:30. 6:30. It'll be done when it's done. Then, I mean, that's kind of how it goes, you know. People eat, and then they sit around and talk until they're just tired of it all, and then they get up and leave. So anyway, this Friday night, starting at 6:30, then right after the bonfire, there will be a lock-in for the kids. And there will also be, immediately after the bonfire, there will be a youth praise team meeting with Jamie for all the teens aged 13 and up. So all of you, you're not even in here. The teens aren't even in here. I mean, I'm just, okay. All right, all of you parents, remind your teens about that. That's kind of weird, isn't it, to sit here and talk to people aren't even in here. Hey, listen, I've actually taught to an empty room before, more than once. Totally empty room. And got it recorded, bless God. And by the time it was over, people who listened to it had no idea. So anyway, that's this coming Friday night. Now, tonight, listen. Tonight is going to be one of the greatest nights in your life. What'd you say? Pastor's not preaching? Oh, no. It's not going to be that great, all right? Listen, I know that downstairs there are some cupcakes waiting to be eaten. These cupcakes have been looking forward to this night since their birth. Cupcakes were born to be eaten, and tonight is their night. We can't let them down. Immediately after the service, you can go downstairs and have a cupcake. Now, you might be asking, well, why are we having cupcakes? Well, today is Michaela Legault's 16th birthday. Yes. And she's not in the room. She's downstairs with him. So anyway, we'll get to help her celebrate her birthday today with those cupcakes. But on top of that, a folding party. Now, here's the disappointing part. About half of those letters have already been folded. I know. So it's going to be a matter of using a glue stick, or if you're feeling energetic, you know, you can just start licking. Glue stick's a little bit easier. So anyway, yeah, folding party and cupcakes right after the service tonight downstairs in the fellowship hall. And I want to thank you ahead of time for helping with getting the letters folded. That really means a lot. So anyway, praise God. Going to be fun. Would you please turn in your Bible to John chapter 6. John chapter 6. Give you a moment to get over there. John chapter 6. Of course, I guess it would help if I'd turn over there too. Yeah. Everybody turn there but me, right. John chapter 6. Now, we're kind of jumping here in the middle of a story, but what had happened? Jesus had gone from one side of a lake to the other. We pick the story up, John chapter 6, verse 25. And when they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, Rabbi, when camest thou hither? Jesus answered them and said, Verily, verily, I say unto you, ye seek me not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give you, for him hath God the Father sealed, or identified. Then said they unto him, What shall we do, that we might work the works of God? Jesus answered and said unto them, This is the work of God, that ye believe on him whom he hath sent. Now later on in John, chapter 14, he made the statement, You believe on me, the works that I do, you shall do also. So when it comes to doing the works of God, twice we see that Jesus has made a reference to believing on him. Now, notice this though. Jesus said, You know, you guys are looking for me because you had a good meal. And you're hoping to get another good meal. And I don't know how many of the thousands of people that day understood how they were fed, but it was a miracle. And then Jesus says, You know what? Labor not for the meat which perishes, but for that which endures unto everlasting life. And then they ask him, What shall we do that we might work the works of God? This, when I read this, I wonder, you know, it's almost like they weren't listening. Because Jesus said, Labor not for the meat that perishes, but for that meat which endures into everlasting life. And then they say, Well, okay, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? I think my question might have been, okay, tell me more about this everlasting life and what kind of meat is it I need to eat to get everlasting life? You see what I mean? They say, Well, what must we do to work the works of God? Let me put it a little bit differently. Boy, Jesus, you sure do a whole lot of really neat things. So tell us, what can we do so that we can do what you do, so that we get a big following too, so that we have power working through us. This is kind of similar to what happened in John chapter 3 with Nicodemus. Kind of similar, but it's not the same. And then Jesus says, the work of God. This is the work of God. Believe on him whom he, God, has sent. So they're looking at a meal, they're looking at being used in power, but Jesus is trying to redirect their attention to a spiritual change. Now, they still didn't get it, because verse 30, they said therefore unto him, What sign showest thou then, that we may see and believe thee? What dost thou work? They still didn't get it. They still didn't understand. And I'm not going to go into all the breakdown and everything here, but their focus was more on demonstration. Jesus' focus was on spiritual change. That's what he was trying to get them to look toward. Now turn to Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10. And in Matthew chapter 10, in verse 1, it says, "And when he," meaning Jesus, "had called unto him his 12 disciples," now these are the same 12 that were called apostles, "he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease." Verse 7, he says, "And as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely ye have received, freely give." Now this same story is presented in Luke chapter 9, but we're going to go to Luke chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10 contains more information about, you know, what happened when he sent out the apostles. So Luke chapter 10 takes place after Jesus sent the 12. And in Luke chapter 10, beginning in verse 1, "After these things the Lord appointed other 70 also, and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come." I jump to verse 9. He tells them, "Heal the sick that are therein, and say unto them, the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you." Verse 17. "And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name." Now let's think about what we're seeing here, both when the 12 were sent out and when the 70 were sent out. Jesus essentially gave both groups the same commission, if you will, the same instructions. Go out city to city, tell people the kingdom of God is arrived, is at hand. And then while you're there, you know, cast out devils and get people healed and so on and so forth. So the 12 went out and did that and they came back. The 70 went out and did that and they came back. And, you know, they're really happy. Boy, even the devils are subject unto us. The 12 were clearly identified as apostles. But the 70, there is nothing in Scripture that I have ever found which indicates that the 70 were called anything. In other words, I can't find anything where it says, "and the 70, which later became apostles or prophets or evangelists, or pastors, or whatever." In fact, I can't even find that the 70 are mentioned again anywhere in Scripture. Were they a part of the 120 in the upper room? I don't know. Maybe. Maybe not. I mean, Scripture doesn't definitively say. Now, the point I'm making is, the apostles had this power operating through them, and they did great things. But the 70 also had great power working through them, and the power working through them produced results very similar, well, really identical, to what happened with the 12. Now let's think about casual observers. First off, we have the casual observers who have seen the 12, two by two, going out and doing these things. And they see people getting healed, and they see people having devils cast out, so on and so forth, and they hear the message being preached, the kingdom of God is at hand. Well, a little time passes. Then they see some of the 70, two by two. And as they watch and observe the 70, members of the 70, maybe not all of them, but some of them, and they see the same thing. Why? People are being healed. Devils are being cast out. These guys are saying the same thing. The kingdom of God is at hand. Do you think it's possible that the casual observer, at least some of them, might have looked at members of the 70 and said something like, "Wow, you must be an apostle too." Do you think that's possible? Well, sure. Do you think it's possible that they might have started talking about, you know, whatever the 70, whatever their names were, you know, Bob and Sam, you know? "Hey, Bob and Sam, did you see what they did when they came to town? I'm telling you, those guys are apostles too. We need to go to their next meeting." Do you understand what I'm saying here? It would have been very easy for people to say, "Well, the apostles are doing this over here, and these guys over here are doing the same thing. They must be apostles too." And yet, maybe eventually they were. I don't know. But I can't find in Scripture where they were ever identified specifically as having a ministry calling of apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, etc., and so on. But to people watching this, they would have had that call, one of those calls, on their life. "Hey, weren't you one of the 70? Yeah, that Jesus sent you out? I remember when you came to our town. Man, I'm telling you what, a terrible thing that they crucified Jesus, but you know, praise God that he was raised from the dead. And man, I was in Jerusalem the day that the Holy Ghost fell and all this. And boy, I tell you what, look, we got a group of believers over here in, you know, pick a city, Bethsaida. Man, we'd sure like you and maybe some of the other apostles that you went out with to come in and hold a crusade in our city." Can you see how that could have happened? I don't know that it did, but people aren't any different today than what they were 2,000 years ago. Now move over to Matthew 24. Look over here. Matthew chapter 24, with all this in mind. In Matthew chapter 24, beginning in verse 3, Jesus says, "He sat upon the Mount of Olives. The disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you." Verse 11, "And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many." Verse 24, "For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect." Or another way to say that would be, if it's possible for even the very elect to be deceived, they're going to be deceived. If it's possible that one of those who is the very elect to be deceived, they will be deceived. If these false prophets do something and there is a deceivable area in the very elect, they'll be deceived. Now think of this. The false prophets are going to do things. What do false prophets do? Declare, speak, teach, preach. That's what they're talking about. They're in the body of Christ because he's speaking beyond the cross here. And he says that these guys are going to have an audience. They're going to have a following. And even the very elect will give ear to them. And some members of the very elect will most likely be deceived. However, verse 13, "He that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved." Now, I'm not going to be teaching Matthew 24 tonight, but verse 13, what he's talking about is, he that endures, or he that holds on to the truth and refuses to allow himself to be deceived by the false prophets and all the other stuff that goes on, that's the person who's going to be saved. That's the person who's going to make it into eternity with Jesus. Now let's just speculate here for a moment. Let's think about this. Jesus was talking past the cross in Matthew 24. That means past his death and resurrection. So, you know, it says Jesus rose on the third day. Okay, starting the fourth day. That's what he's talking about here. But the end times. Well, in this, what if one of the 70 got to thinking, you know, this power was operating in my life, and began to talk to people about, listen, Jesus Christ himself appointed me. Jesus Christ himself, the one that you all know has risen from the dead, the one that appeared to many of you because you were members of the 500. Remember, he appeared unto 500 people and so forth. All right, Jesus himself handpicked me and sent me out as a member of the elite 70. And we went out two by two and we ministered and we were getting people healed and just incredible things happened, so on and so forth. Now, folks, I want you to know this. I am still ministering on behalf of Jesus. Now, do you think that would have an impact on listeners? To know that that person had been a part of the 70 and had been used of God in a mighty way and would stand up and begin sharing testimonies of how we went into this city and we went into that city and went over here to this village and to that town and laid hands on this one and prayed for that one and did this and cast these devils out. All these testimonies. Do you think people would start giving them ear? Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, even though people would give them ear, we still don't see anything in Scripture that they were specifically called to be evangelists or to be apostles. We don't. Now, I'm not saying that they weren't. What I'm saying is we don't see it in Scripture. Now, this is very important where we're headed here. Now, turn over to Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. Now, Jesus is getting ready to ascend back into heaven. And he's talking to the apostles. Judas is dead, so there are basically 11. And he says in verse 15, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." Notice what is missing in this. "Go ye into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, and he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe." These signs shall follow them that believe. There is no mention in this that they shall all be called a pastor, an evangelist. You see this? Seriously, you need to really pay attention to this. There's nothing in here about a ministry calling. Nothing. No reference to it at all. None. Zero. He just says, these signs shall follow them that believe. These signs shall follow them that believe. Now, we're not going to get into the, you know, well, how much belief do you have? What we want to focus on is the fact that he said, these signs shall follow them that believe. Okay, then, next question, or a question. Are these signs following people who believe? Yes. Back then and today. Remember Stephen, the guy who was the, you know, table waiter. Signs followed. But there's nothing that indicates Stephen was called. I know he stood up and I know he preached. I know that. And I know he gave the testimony of Christ. But there's nothing in Scripture that says Stephen, the evangelist, preached the word to the people. See this? It doesn't say Stephen the apostle, Stephen the pastor, Stephen the whatever. It doesn't say that. It just says Stephen did these things. He that believeth, these signs shall follow. These signs shall follow. He does not say that these people, let me say it another way. He did not say in here that the signs following qualified them to operate in a ministry calling. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now here's the problem. When signs begin to follow, we begin to exalt. When signs begin to take place, we begin to promote. Man, not God. Jesus didn't say, when these signs begin to follow, thou shalt be promoted into ministry. It's not in there. Well, here's what happens. You know, God's anointing can move on a person for a specific purpose, a specific time, a specific something. But that anointing for that time, place, and event is not the ongoing spiritual strength and maturity that is necessary for all believers, which is produced through regular fellowship with the Holy Spirit. It's not the same thing. But the body of Christ says it is. So here's what you have. And I'm going to use healing because that's the one that's most visible, if you will. You know, so here's, you know, Ralph. Ralph gets saved, praise God, you know, filled with the Holy Ghost. And so he begins praying for people. And boy, you know, this lady over here, why, she had a backache, got healed. It's like, well, praise God. Wow, Ralph, you know, glory. Well, then, you know, Ralph comes over here and he prays for somebody else that, you know, they had a bad ankle. And, oh, the ankle's healed. It's amazing. You know, wow, look at me. I'm okay. Ralph prayed for me. I'm all healed. Somebody over here, been battling migraine headaches for 30 years. Ralph prays. And the person says, whoa, my head feels so different. Why, this is amazing. Ever since Ralph prayed for me, I've never had another migraine. And then Ralph prays for this person over here, and wow, an eyeball gets formed in an empty eye socket. What do you think is starting to happen in Ralph's life? People are talking about Ralph. People are lifting Ralph up and talking about Ralph's ministry. And Ralph begins getting invitations to come and minister. Pastor, you need to have Ralph come and preach. Why? Because so many people have been healed in his ministry. Really? Yeah. I mean, my Aunt Susie, why, you know, she had bursitis. And I don't even know what that is, but she got healed. I didn't even know she had burrs, but they all got healed. Yeah. You understand what I'm saying? And pretty soon Ralph has a following. And pretty soon Ralph has a ministry. And then one day, Ralph gets a phone call. Brother Ralph, would you please come and preach in our church? Well, okay, let me check my schedule. Yes, I have that week open. No problem. Brother Ralph shows up. And he stands up and he shares and prays for people, and more people get healed. Some people, boom, they get slain in the spirit, fall on the floor. All kinds of really neat things happen. Third night of the week's conference, the week's crusade, whatever you want to call it, week's revival. The third night, one of them called Ralph and said, could you just here in the back room, could you come talk to us for a minute? So Ralph goes into the back room, and there's the church council. Brother Ralph, as you know, we have been without a pastor now for 6 months. And it's obvious God has his hand on you. Because people are healed when you pray for them. Would you consider being our pastor? Here's what we can offer you. Now, Ralph may not be seeking after the money, but generally that's going to come up in the conversation anyway. And so, you know, Ralph, he prays about it. Let me get back with you. Well, anyway, Ralph ends up being the pastor. Does that mean that everything's going to go the way it should be? Nope. See, here's the problem. I don't care if you walk into funeral homes and raise the dead out of every casket. That does not mean you're ready for a ministry calling. I don't care how many people you pray for and get healed. That doesn't mean you're ready for a ministry calling. In fact, some of the most immature Christians you'll ever meet can pray and people get healed. And just because somebody is used to give a word of knowledge, a word of wisdom, a prophetic word, just because that happens, it does not mean that person is at a place to where God is moving them into a ministry calling. Now, everybody and their brother is probably going to tell them, oh, you're called to be a prophet. Oh, you're called to be an apostle. You're called to be an evangelist. You're called to... Everybody's going to confirm to them they're called to be something, and they're going to start believing they're called to be something because, after all, when I pray for people to get healed, what can you brag about? Truth? Healing doesn't change a person's life. Truth will. Healing just gets your body healed. Truth brings transformation. Granted, you have to apply it when you hear it. This is a major, 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 major problem in the body of Christ. And there are people who are held in high esteem in the eyes of many people who serve as evangelist, pastor, whatever it would be. They don't need to be operating in that ministry because it doesn't matter if they've been born again, filled with the Holy Ghost for 35 years. Just because they pray for somebody does not mean they're spiritually mature enough to step into the operation of a ministry calling, and it doesn't mean they know the word well enough to be able to declare it. You've got churches all over the place. Proof, you drive around town, you see all these churches, there's no way God has established all those churches. You're not dumb. You know that. How many times have you thought, you know, man, look at all these churches around here. Boy, oh boy. That's not cause for rejoice. That's cause for sadness. Because it just proves you got people doing stuff that they shouldn't be doing. I'll let you in on a secret. There are times when I've talked to God and said, God, I'm not even sure I'm supposed to be doing anything. You know, when I start comparing myself to what I see in Scripture, it's like, I don't know about me, that's for sure. And just because somebody prays for somebody and there's a healing, just because somebody says, man, I'd love to go out and tell people about Jesus, I'd love to go out and witness on the street corners, or I'd love to go into the prisons, or I'd love to go here, I'd love to tell, praise God! That's wonderful, but that doesn't mean you are qualified to operate in a ministry calling. It just means, what? These signs shall follow them that believe. That's all it means. The signs are following you. That's it. It doesn't mean you're functioning in a ministry calling. And there are so many Christians who have been led astray by people who were promoted by people. Well, if God wasn't in it, then why would this power be happening? Why would these people be getting healed? How about Mark chapter 16? That's why. Look over in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. See, the problem is once you give somebody a title, it's hard to take it away. How do you look at a pastor and say, you're not fit? How do you look at a pastor and say, okay, great, you got people healed. Praise God for their healing. But you don't know enough about the Word of God to stand up and feed the flock. You don't know enough. You know enough to tell people that Jesus saves. You know enough to tell people about the born-again message that's contained in Scripture. But for crying out loud, every Christian should be able to do that. All Christians should be able to stand up and tell people about the born-again message that's in Scripture. That's fundamental. That's basic. That's born-again 101. Every Christian should be able to do that. The thing is, if you're not able to share enough of the Word of God to disciple believers into a deeper walk with Jesus Christ, you're not fit to stand behind the pulpit and call yourself a pastor. I'm not trying to be mean. I'm just telling you, this is how it works. There is accountability. And if you study the New Testament from Romans beyond, you're going to see exactly what I'm talking about. You know, the Apostle Paul, God through him gave a warning, you better not promote a novice. You better not. Well, that's somebody who's born again, filled with the Holy Ghost. You don't promote them just because they pray for people and the people get healed. Okay, well, praise God for that. I'm happy for that. I really am. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, look here in verse 4. I thank my God always on your behalf for the... Now, this is the Apostle Paul writing to these people. He says, I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything you are enriched by him, in all utterance and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. This come behind in no gift is not talking about an offering. Because when you read 1 and 2 Corinthians, you can see where Paul was bringing correction to that church concerning offerings. And the fact that some of them didn't want to support his ministry. Just read the two books, okay? Just go ahead and read those. He's talking about the gifts of the Spirit in manifestation. He's talking about these signs shall follow them that believe. But when you continue reading in the first chapter, and then you get over into the third chapter, Paul brings a stern rebuke to them. And he says, you know what? I hear there are a lot of divisions in your midst. You know, you guys are saying, I follow this one, I follow that one, I follow this one, I follow that one. Now, why do you think, let's kind of speculate. What do you think might have happened to cause some of these people to be exalted in the eyes of others? Maybe they prayed for some people and they got healed. Maybe a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, the gifts being in operation. Couple that with a persuasive personality, and all of a sudden you've got yourself a pastor, an evangelist, a someone to be followed. You know what, guys? Do you know one of the reasons? I'm going to give you a reason. One of the reasons why this church hasn't grown the way some people think, it's because I do not have a persuasive personality. I don't. You compare me to a bunch of these guys on television, I don't have that kind of personality, that charisma. I don't have that. I know it. I can't fake it. Oh, I could try. Looks stupid in the process. You think, what? Has he been smoking before the service? I know that I'm not like that. Really, I understand that, and I accept that. But you know what? I guess the flip side to that is, I know for a fact the church isn't being built on my personality. That means if anybody shows up and hangs around long for a while, I mean, that means it must be genuine, right? Do you see what I'm getting at in this? Scripture does not say, and certain bunches of people were used in the gifts, and that's why folks followed them in Corinth. However, it's very possible that's how it happened because the gifts were in operation and they had all these groups and all these factions and all this stuff was going on. For us, Jesus made the statement, false prophets were going to rise. Now in Matthew, well in fact, turn back over to Matthew 24, and I just want you to see this again. Matthew 24. Now, we're not going to turn to any other place in the four Gospels right now. We're only going to look in Matthew 24. Now, I'm saying that because I'm well aware of other things that are said in the other four Gospels about the end times. Okay? Matthew 24, look what Jesus says in verse 24. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets and shall show great signs and wonders. Notice it does not say false signs and wonders. See this? You see, the operation of the gifts, false signs and wonders, healings, miracles, prophetic words, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, and so on, those are the kind of things that fuel people's interests to listen to what a person has to say. And he says that these false prophets, when he uses the word prophet, but to help you understand the fullness of what he's saying here, we could say this and be correct. False apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. He's basically talking about those who deliver the word of God. And he's saying, they'll show signs and wonders. Now, I know another place it talks about false signs and wonders. But if somebody gets healed, somebody gets healed, okay? There's nothing false about a genuine healing. And he says, they're going to show this. However, accompanying the healing or the whatever is going to be a message of error. The problem is that the message of error is going to be blended with the name of Jesus and Scripture. That's how even the very elect can be deceived. So we have people today operating in ministry who have been used in the gifts, have been used, you know, healings, whatever it would be, prophetic whatevers, and they get exalted in front of others. They end up with the ministry. Well, once that starts, man, I'm telling you, it's possible that their eyes could be open to see the problems, but I've never heard of it. You remember the story of the emperor in his new clothes? Remember that? The guys that were sewing his new clothes, well, there weren't any clothes there. And at first the emperor says, what? I don't see anything. What? You can't see this? Why, look at this. Look at this. And they were being paid all kinds of money. And then the day came for the emperor to be on parade. And they acted like they were helping the emperor to get dressed. Well, his pride refused to acknowledge the fact he's in his underwear. And so as he goes out in the parade, he's walking around in his underwear and everybody's laughing at him. Everybody's making fun of him. These guys took the money and ran. Pride is what will keep people from receiving truth. Do you remember what Paul wrote to Timothy? He said, you know what? All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's profitable for doctrine and, you know, reproof and correction, instruction and righteousness. And he says, Timothy, don't give up. Now, I'm paraphrasing Paul's message to Timothy. You can read about it in both 1 and 2 Timothy. He says, Timothy, it doesn't matter what they say about you. It doesn't matter who turns their back on you. It doesn't matter how they treat you. You need to stand strong on the word and deliver truth and rebuke even if they don't receive it. Well, I'm telling you right now, there are people out there in the body of Christ, they don't receive it. They don't receive it because of the pride. And when you add the gifts operating, people being healed, prophetic words, whatever. Hey, look, In the Old Testament, didn't God prophesy through a donkey? Well, some people think it's still going on today. Okay. Hallelujah. Do you guys understand what I'm getting at? One of the hardest things in the world for us to do, how can I say this, is to shake the dust off our feet and separate ourselves from those kind of people. And it's not a matter of the gifts, it's not a matter of the healings, it's a matter of what's coming out of your mouth. What are you saying? What are you teaching? What, you know, and I don't want to go too, anyway, too many Christians today focus on the gifts when they should be focusing on what it means to live a Christ-like life. And too many of these preachers, if God weren't blessing what I'm doing, then how come these people are getting healed? Mark 16, that's why. You believe. You're praying for people. See, it wasn't spiritual maturity that caused the gifts to operate in the church at Corinth. The proof of that is how Paul had to rebuke them over and over and over for all the junk. Spiritual maturity had nothing to do with it. They just believed. They were believers. And the gifts were in operation. This is going to increase. It's increasing now. You know, a while back you had some guy down in Florida that was kicking people and slamming people around. And, you know, some folks got healed. Some people wanted to say that none of the healings were real. I don't believe that. I think some of the healings were real. I don't have any documentation. But one thing I do know is this. God's not going to tell you to kick some old person in the face and then call them healed. Yeah, I got your, you know, red wing boot imprint right here on my face. Looks like I got a tattoo. That's crazy. Absolutely. And then that preacher, it come to find out, was going out, boozing it up, cheating on his wife. And a lot of the people who supported him refused to separate themselves from his ministry. They refused. Even though we are admonished in Scripture to separate ourselves from such people. It doesn't say you stop loving or stop praying for them. It just, you know, you just don't do that. You do not reinforce their self-delusion by supporting them. You call them to account for this. And I can tell you, there are people over the years of my own ministry, I've tried. They won't hear it. They won't receive it. They won't listen to it. It's like, you know what? And I point them to the Scripture. I mean, I give them Scripture. I point them to the Word. I point them to, you know, the principles of what's recorded in Scripture and so forth. Doesn't work. Doesn't work. Well, you know what? We need to guard ourselves against this, because one of the hardest things to do is to shake the dust off when that person is like your best friend. Well, I've known him for, you know, 50 years. We went to school together, elementary school on. I've known him. Why? You know, I was there when he got saved, there when he got filled with the Holy Ghost, there when he went to Bible college, there when he did this, there when he did that, and so on. Why, he's a good person. You know, every time somebody says that, what defines good? What defines good? It's whatever you think. You define, yep, that's a good person. Well, are you sure? Remember what Jesus said, why callest thou me good? There's none good but, you know, God himself. Guys, you have to guard yourself. Because when you open your life up to people like that, and I'm not talking about, you know, you're mean and harsh to people. I think you understand what I mean when I say when you open your life up to people like that. Whatever is going on in their life, you better watch out. Because that kind of discord can be sown in you. And Satan will help all he can. Remember, these false prophets, they couldn't deceive anybody if nobody received them. The reason that the people were deceived was because they opened themselves up to what was operating in those false prophets. And will be doing. I mean, this is still going on. This is a living passage today. So just because you hear that somebody is operating in the gifts, that somebody's getting people healed, that somebody is being used in the word of wisdom and the word of... Okay, praise God for it. I hope it's all genuine. But that does not mean they have been promoted by God into a ministry calling. Now, I don't doubt that there's a ministry calling for them. But our maturity doesn't come when the gifts are operating through us. The maturity comes based upon the Word of God. So, guys, we need to take this to heart. We need to be prepared for what is happening and what will be happening and what will continue to increase, because I'm guessing there's a good chance those of you here, those watching, those listening, you're going to come in contact with somebody like this. And in some cases, they might be the nicest person in the world. But it doesn't mean they're ready. It doesn't mean that they are... They may know what their calling is. Maybe they are called to be a pastor, but it doesn't mean they're ready. It just means you better watch out. Now, guys, as we continue in this, and we go forward with the Lord, looking for His return, be aware, this is going to increase more and more. What is a false prophet? What is a false apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher? It's not somebody who tells you to worship the devil. It's somebody who may have that calling on their life, but they have gone beyond. And I heard Tim Stemple one time said, "Do not minister beyond your anointing." And when you get out there ahead of your anointing and God's grace, that's when you are opening yourself up to all kinds of goofiness. And you may not be a goofy person. When I say goofiness, I'm just talking about how you preach, what you preach, what you teach, how you minister to people. And anyway, Holy Spirit, help me to be steeled against this, because it is very persuasive. Praise God. All right, go ahead and stand. Father, I thank you for your word tonight. And Father, it's possible that some people hearing this were thinking of someone they know that was described by what we've seen in your word. That person could be a friend, it could be a spouse, it could be a family member, it could be their pastor, it could even be somebody who preached in their church last week. I don't know. But Father, we have to be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might to withstand all of these things in the evil day. And I thank you for your grace, Father. And I thank you, Father, I thank you that the apostles asked Jesus that question. What will be the sign of your return in the end of the world? Because that opened the door for Jesus to give us one of the greatest teachings contained in Scripture. The greatest warnings. Thank you, Father. And Father, I ask you to minister to me, to help me stay on the path of truth. Help me, Father, just move on me with a strong check on the inside of me, whatever, so that I don't veer off to the right or to the left, but Father, I stay centered on your word. And I pray the same for every person here because, Father, we are all called. And you want to use us. Thank you so much, Father, for what you're doing in our midst. Thank you, Father, for working in us to will and to do of your good pleasure. May the fullness of your good pleasure be magnified in us. And Father, we again want to lift up Missy DiSerio, her family, and John's family, and ask you to continue to minister peace and strength to them, that, Father, the joy of the Lord would be their strength. And that, Father, whatever, Father, I don't know everything Missy is facing, but I know that you will provide and supply all the need for her and those two boys. So I thank you for this, Father. I praise you for this. And Father, I am so glad to know that John is rejoicing before the throne of Jesus. Hallelujah. So Father, as we leave here tonight, just thank you for touching us. Thank you for your presence. And I say, Jesus Christ is Lord over this ministry. In your name, Jesus, amen. Amen. Well, look, if you have an offering tonight, go ahead and bring it up before you leave. And don't forget, cupcakes and folding party. Yes. All right, we'll see you guys downstairs.